Friends, welcome to GYAS. How are you? I hope you're doing well. So friends, as you know that on our channel we are covering the syllabus of UPSC Civil Services, and for that purpose we have started multiple series on our channel that target your prelims as well as mains. So currently we have 12 series that target your prelims and one series that target your mains. So what we do in these prelims oriented series, we have done basically the division of your whole syllabus into 12 subtopics, and we have allocated each day for two topics, and in this manner in 6 days we cover your all 12 subtopics in a MCQ format. So this process goes on in a cyclic manner, and we cover your 12 subtopics in 6 days, and this process goes on and on in cyclic manner, and we will continue to do so till 31st May. So why the date chosen has been 31st May? Because on 2nd June is your prelims of UPSC CSE 2019, and we will end this series only one day before your prelims exam. So let's start our discussion, friends. So this is lecture number 13. So we are discussing geography portion. So geography lecture number 13 we will be discussing in this video. So let's see what is the first question. First question is, which of the following are the salient features of fold mountains? First, they are least likely to have conical peaks. Second, they are created when large areas are broken and displaced vertically. Third, they must be associated with volcanism either from the mountain core or in its vicinity. So we have to choose that which of the above statements is correct. Let me tell you, friends, that first is clearly wrong, because they have conical peaks, and these fold mountains have conical peaks, and the second thing is that they are not created where large areas are broken. In fact, they are created where the large folds have formed due to merging of two plates. So for example, Himalayas or Alps mountains of your South America, they are basically they are fold mountains. So second is also wrong, because such type of mountains which are created by the large areas which are broken, they are called block mountains and not fold mountains. About third statement, friend, third statement is also wrong. It is not necessary that volcanism must be associated with mountain core or its vicinity. It may be possible that volcanism may not be associated with fold mountains. For example, the very best example is of Ravli mountains, which are old fold mountains, but they have no volcanism associated in the mountain core, or for that matter in their vicinity. So all of these statements are incorrect. So the D is the answer. So solution is D. Here is the explanation. Himalayan mountains and Alps are the young fold mountains with rugged relief and high conical peaks, and Appalachians in North America and Ural mountains in Russia, they have basically rounded features and low elevation because they are old fold mountains and they have eroded to a considerable extent. About second statement, friends, second statement is about block mountains and not fold mountains. Block mountains are those mountains which are formed when when a plate is displaced vertically and it is broken. So it is the uplifted blocks are called host, and the load blocks are called graben. So regarding third statement is also wrong, as I have given you the explanation about Ravli range. Let's move on to the second question. Second question is, even when Earth gets nearest to the Sun at perihelion, the effects of this increased solar insolation are not felt on a large scale on Earth. This can be due to A, increase in cloudiness in major continental regions; B, reduction in solar discharge; C, blowing of sea and land breeze; D, adiabatic wind flow pattern. So friends, perihelion is basically a position in which Earth is closest to the Sun, and it is the question is saying that basically the effect of this increased solar insolation is not felt, and why this is so. Let me tell you, friends, that because of the differential heating of land and sea, the processes of temperature distribution start between sea and land, and this leads to blowing of sea and land breezes and the distribution of overall temperature. That's why the increased solar insolation doesn't make much impact due to this reason, or that is blowing of the sea and land breezes, because it maintains your temperature to a considerable level. So C is the appropriate answer for this question. So answer is here. So I have already explained to you that variation in solar output does not have a large effect on daily weather changes on Earth at a certain point, because of the distribution of land and sea heat transfer by way of sea and land breezes extra redistribute the increased insolation, so that the effects are not felt on a large scale. So C is correct. Let's move on to your next question. Next question is third question. Consider the following about Ring of Fire. So about the Ring of Fire. First, it is region of in the basin of Atlantic Ocean. Second, it is shaped like a horseshoe. Third, it is associated with nearly continuous series of oceanic trenches. So we have to choose that which of the above statements is correct. Let me tell you, friends, that first is clearly wrong. Ring of Fire is not in Atlantic Ocean, rather it is in the basin of Pacific Ocean. Regarding second statement, friends, yes, it is correct. It is a horseshoe shoe-shaped type of ring, and it approximately covers 40,000 square kilometer. So third is it is associated with nearly a continuous series of oceanic trenches, which are further associated with volcanism as well as earthquakes. So the world's most active volcanoes and dormant volcanoes, basically 80% of the world's 70 to 80% of the world's active volcanoes and dormant volcanoes are found in this region of Ring of Fire, and also world's 90% of the earthquakes and 80% of the high intensity earthquakes, they take place in this Ring of Fire. So the answer is second and third only. So the solution is B. As I have already told you, that is it is an area in the basin of Pacific Ocean where large earthquakes and volcanic eruptions occur. So it is basically 40,000 kilometer horseshoe shape shape, which is associated with continuous series of oceanic trenches, volcanic area arcs and volcanic belts and plate movements. They are home to about 75% of the world's active and dormant volcanoes, and also about world's 90% of the world's earthquakes and 81% of the world's largest earthquakes occur in this Ring of Fire. So this is about your third question. Let's move on to the fourth question. Fourth question is, Coriolis force acting on the fluid in the river water deflects it like it deflects the wind. This Coriolis force is generated by. So here we have been asked that there is a force called Coriolis force which causes deflection in the river water. Basically which is caused due to the deflection in the wind. So this Coriolis force is generated by which of the following? A. Meandering motion of the river. B. Rotation of earth. C. Revolution of earth around the sun. D. Adhesive force of the water molecules with each other. So friends, it is a very easy question. The answer is rotation of earth. So basically rotation of earth leads to generation of this Coriolis force, and this Coriolis force is highest in polar areas and lowest in at the equator. So this this basically causes your river water to deflect, and also the wind to deflect, and more the speed is of the wind, more will be the deflection. Slower the speed of the wind, slower will be the deflection, and higher is the altitude, the higher will be the deflection, because at equator the Coriolis force is zero. So the answer is B. So here is the explanation, so you can see it. So it reflects the wind to the right direction in the northern hemisphere and to the left direction in the southern hemisphere. So as I've already told you in detail explanation, let's move on to the fifth question. Fifth question is, arrival of the southwest monsoons after summer solstice leads to which of the following phenomena? So here we have been talking about the northern hemisphere. So some arrival of these southwest monsoons when summer solstice occurs, it leads to which of the following phenomena in India? First, the temperature at tropics becomes higher than that of the region near equator. Second, brings western disturbances to India. So we have to choose that which of the following above statements is correct, which of the above statements is associated with coming of southwest monsoons. Let me tell you, friends, the first is certainly not the case, because temperature at tropics is basically higher due to the cloudiness condition in equator, at equators. So at equators the evaporation takes place to a considerable degree due to the availability of moisture, so the clouds form. So the clouds deflect a large amount of sunlight that is coming from sun, and thus equator is not that much hotter as the tropics are. Tropic of Cancer and Capricorn are. So the temperature is basically higher at tropics because of non-formation of the clouds. So first is certainly not associated with southwest monsoons, and also second is not certainly not associated because western disturbances, they are actually they come in winter season and not in summer season. So obviously summer solstice, southwest monsoon, they come in summer season. So second is also not the case. So which of the fall above is correct? None is correct. So the D would be the answer. So here is the explanation, as I have already told you in detail. Let's move on to the sixth question. Sixth question is, the right conditions for growing cotton are: A. High temperature, light rainfall, frost-free days and bright sunshine. B. Freezing temperature, heavy rainfall, frost-free days and bright sunshine. C. Moderate temperature, heavy rainfall and cloudy weather. D. Low temperature, low rainfall and cloudy weather. So we have to choose the correct statement. Let me tell you, friends, that the correct statement is the appropriate conditions for growing of cotton are high temperature, light rainfall, frost-free days and bright sunshine. So A is the answer. So here is the explanation. So So you can see cotton is basically grown in the latitudes of 37 degree north and 30 degree south in temperate subtropical tropical regions and on every continent. So ideal conditions are given here. So temperature must be 18 to 30 degree and there must be long vegetation period without frost, and ample sunshine should be there, and fairly dry condition should be there, and minimum of 500 millimeter of water deep between germination and bowl formation, and also deep well drained soils with a good nutrient content. It grows best on black and alluvial soils. So China, followed by USA, India, Pakistan, Brazil, and Egypt are the leading producers of the cotton. So this is about your sixth question. Let's move on to the seventh question. Seventh question is, what makes the Atlantic Ocean a good location for natural harbors and ports? A. Its straight coastlines. B. Shallow depth of ocean near sedimentary deposits. C. Its highly indented coastline. D. Its unconsolidated sedimentary deposits are S-shaped. Let me tell you, friends, that the correct answer is C. That is, it has highly indented coastline, which is good for natural harbors and ports. So let me tell you, friends, that Atlantic Ocean is also the busiest ocean from the commercial point of view, because North America and the Northern Hemisphere contains North America and the Europe, which are the most developed regions of the world. So that's why there is a quite robust trade, sea trade. So that's why it is busiest commercial ocean. So C is the answer. So here is the explanation. So Atlantic Ocean is, yes, it is second largest ocean in the world. It has S shaped, but it is not responsible for the it cannot be considered an ideal location for harbors, and also this coastline is highly indented. That's why the reason is that there are natural harbors and ports. So you can see here the in the diagram, so you can see here there is a considerable degree of indentedness in the coastline. So this indented coastline provides you the ideal condition for your ports and harbors. Let's move on to the eighth question. Eighth question is, these tribes are recognized among other Naga people by their tattoos found all over their face and hands. They are also known as India's last surviving headhunters. The tribe is A. Angla, B. Nori, C. Konyak, D. Mishmi. So let me tell you, friends, the correct answer is C. Basically, these are Konyak. They are found in, they are the largest tribe type population among the Nagas, and they have facial tattoos, and which is earned after taking enemy's head. But now they have discontinued this practice, but they were quite popular till 1960s due to their practice of fierce head hunting history. So they are considerably threatening. I would not use this word, but sorry for its usage, but certainly it is a matter of kind of you can say that it arouses the curiosity of a person that there could be a certain tribe that could go for head hunting. So let's move on to the ninth question. Ninth question is, winter rainfall in northern India in Punjab and Haryana occurs mainly due to A. Arrival of weak temperate cyclones from Mediterranean Sea, B. Northeast monsoon crossing over the Bay of Bengal, C. Anticyclone circulation patterns in northern India in winter, D. All of the above. Let me tell you, friends, that winter rainfall in northern India is basically associated with the arrival of weak temperate cyclones from the Mediterranean Sea. So basically they are also termed as western disturbances, but they are basically extratropical cyclones that originate over the Mediterranean Sea, and they drive their moisture from the Mediterranean Sea itself, and they move towards India and Indian subcontinent under the influence of westerlies, the westerly winds, and they bring ample amount of rainfall in the northwestern India, which is quite helpful in for the rabi crops. So A is the answer. So arrival of weak temperate cyclones from the Mediterranean Sea is basically responsible for this rainfall. Certainly B is not the answer, because this northeast monsoon crossing over the Bay of Bengal, it is responsible for rainfall in Tamil Nadu and this other portions, Andhra Pradesh, and it is not responsible for rainfall in northern India. About C, this anticyclonic circulation patterns in northern India in winter is basically this results in movement of wind from land to sea. So certainly the wind is dry, so there will be there is no kind of any moisture that is shed by this circulation pattern. So C is certainly not the answer. So A is the answer. So here is the explanation, as I have already provided you in detail explanation, that western disturbances are basically these are extratropical storms that originate over Mediterranean Sea. So they are responsible for the development of rabi crop locally, and which includes the locally staple important staple, that is wheat. So this is about your ninth question. Let's move on to the tenth question. Tenth question is, consider the following statements. A, the rivers that originate in Western Ghats flow only eastwards are the Indian Peninsula slopes downward to the eastern side from Western Ghats. Let me tell you, friends, that we have to choose the correct answer. Let me tell you clearly, A is wrong. Because if there is a kind of, we can say, slope towards east direction, then there will be certainly a slope towards the west direction also. So it is not the case that the rivers that originate in Western Ghats, they only flow eastwards. For example, there are examples of Narmada Tapi that flow westwards, that and they originate from Western Ghats. So certainly A is incorrect, but let me tell you, R is correct. The Indian Peninsula slopes downward to the eastern side from Western Ghats. So considerable number of rivers, for example, these Mahanadi, Godavari, Kaveri, this Krishna Kaveri, all these flow towards your eastern coastline, due to the slope that is downward toward the eastern side. So I is incorrect, R is correct. So here is the explanation. So answer is C, that is A is incorrect, but R is correct. So here is the explanation. So you can see it, as I've already told you. So there is no need to waste time here. So this is all about, friends, today's lecture. If you like the questions, if you like the video, then please ensure that you do hit a like and also share it with your friends, and also ensure that you subscribe to our channel, and also do not forget to press the bell icon, because then only you will get all the important notifications relating to our updates on UPSC CSE 2019. And lastly, friends, if you want the PDFs of these MCQs, you can contact us at this email ID, that is achieveies21@gmail.com, or you can contact us at this contact number, that is 8968426481. So this is our official number, that is the number of our YouTube channel, that is Achieve IAS. So you can contact us at this number also, and this email ID also, in case you want to subscribe to the PDF. So certainly there will be a fee structure for it, but it is kept as minimum as possible so that you can afford it. And also this fee has been kept for the purpose of our motivation, so that we also remain motivated to help you people. So if you like the video, then please ensure that you do hit a like. So thank you, friends. Have a very nice day. Thank you very much.